Hey film fans, in 1992, an American indie film was released that featured a scene where the characters sit around the table and deconstruct Madonna, pick Madonna apart. You know the scene I'm talking about, right? It goes something like this.
Madonna exploits her sexuality on her own terms.
What does it mean to exploit your sexuality on your own terms?
It means you name the price.
Madonna is a successful business person.
I like old-fashioned, straight-ahead rock and roll.
She sings okay.
The representation of female sexuality that she offers is of strength and self-determination.
What? That's not the scene you were thinking of? That scene comes from the 1992 film Simple Men, which is the final film in the so-called Long Island Trilogy by writer-director Hal Hartley. And it's also the subject of this episode of What Makes This Film Great. Simple Men was written and directed by Hal Hartley, and once again it features cinematography by Michael Spiller. Once again, Hartley brings in a new editor, Steve Hamilton, where Hartley himself had edited The Unbelievable Truth and brought in Nick Gomez for Trust. And Hamilton's editing brings something extra to the film, and I'll talk about that a little bit later in the video. The film features a cast that by now will be recognizable to people who've been watching Hartley films. Martin Donovan, Robert John Burke, Karen Sillis, who played the nurse so memorably in Trust, is one of the featured performers in this film. And you'll notice a lot of the secondary characters have been populating all of Hartley's films before this one. It also features the first appearance in a Hartley film of Alina Lowenson, who would go on to feature not only in Hartley's films later, but a wide range of 90s and 2000s films, a lot of indie films. And she gives a wonderful, really important performance. And it also features Bill Sage, who has been a bit of a bit player in previous Hartley films, but now plays one of the two brothers who are the central protagonists of the film. Simple Men is classified as part of the Long Island Trilogy, and the Long Island Trilogy is not something that these three films, The Unbelievable Truth, Trust, and Simple Men, were categorized as or qualified as in the early 90s when the films were coming out. But though it's called the Long Island Trilogy and it features characters from and around Long Island, and all three films are mostly set on Long Island, although not always filmed there, this film is different in a lot of ways. It's kind of a road movie in a sense. Its thrust is different. It concerns two brothers who are searching for their father. And for the first time in Hartley's work, even though there are prominent women featured in the film, it feels like the men, perhaps thus the title, it feels like the men are the protagonists of the film. Maybe because Adrienne Shelley is not appearing in it, and that sort of immense, magnanimous on-screen charm that she has is not available, although all the performers are great in this film. Or maybe it just has to do with the way Hartley's writing sort of moved closer to the men in this film. So that gives it a different feel as well. Also, and I'll come to this in more detail, Hartley really is pushing a lot of the stuff I talked about in previous videos, that kind of non-naturalist mannered acting, the sort of non-naturalist dialogue as well. The repetition, the sort of circular dialogue that comes back to the beginning of itself, branches out in different ways. It's not quite so sort of prescriptive as it was in that restaurant scene in The Unbelievable Truth, but it's the same technique, only you can see that Hartley's really kind of flexing his muscle, and in a lot of ways, combined with the film's cinematography and that editing that I'm going to get to, it pushes the film, even more than the first two, into a kind of almost confrontational area in terms of its relationship with the viewers. This film calls attention to itself, and it does so for reasons that I'll explore in the rest of this video. Just a quick plot summary. Robert John Burke plays Bill, and Bill Sage plays Dennis, and these are two brothers who are looking for their father. Their father is a former standout shortstop for the Los Angeles Dodgers who became radicalized in the 60s and may or may not have planted a bomb at the Pentagon. Since that time, he's been on the run, and as the film begins, he's been arrested and then escaped from prison. And so now the two brothers are looking for him. The two brothers come from different walks of life. It never goes into detail about their upbringing. It sort of mentions here and there that their father was never around, that they don't know him that well, and the film implies that that might be why the two brothers took their lives in two different directions. But Bill, the older brother, has kind of followed a life of crime, and some of the funny parts of the film are where he sort of philosophizes or even gets a little defensive about why crime is okay.
Listen, Dennis, let me tell you something about the law. The law is just a contract. A contract between the rich people who own everything and the poor people who want to take it away from them. And the contract says, if you break the law and you get away with it, fine. But if you break the law and you get caught, you got to play by the rules and pay the price. It's no big moral thing. You don't need an ideology to knock over a liquor store.
Leave me alone.
Dennis has taken another route. He's a college student, a university student, studying philosophy. And in a way, we're given to believe that these are two sides of the father. So even though the father never took part in raising them or only sporadically, Dennis has taken on his thoughtful, philosophical side, which led to his radicalism. And Bill has taken on the more sort of criminal side, which led to the father being on the run. And these two brothers decide to travel to Long Island from New York City because they've got a few tips of where their father might be. And that's how the story gets going. And they have a few zany adventures along the way, including meeting a guy called Ned Rifle, and I'll try to circle back around to him at the end. Ned Rifle's the guy they get a motorcycle from, which leads the police to start looking for them. So there's a whole fugitive on the run slash road trip angle to the film. And they end up in a small town in Long Island where they meet two women and another man who may or may not have connections to the father. And that's the story. Along the way, the two brothers and then the other three that they meet talk about the meaning of life. Karen Sillis plays a gardener who just wants to plant trees and create life and make life grow and blossom. They talk about political struggle. They talk about parenthood. They talk about personal responsibility. A lot of subjects that come up earlier in Hartley's films, but now they seem a little more desperate. In The Unbelievable Truth and Trust with Adrienne Shelley, because she was young, because in both of those films she plays a high school student, and because she's written as a sort of awakening, naive teenager, there's a sense that her philosophical explorations about nuclear annihilation in the first film or about the meaning of love in the second film, they have a sort of wonderful but juvenile aspect to them. Whereas in Simple Men, where we have people on the run for crimes or possible crimes, we have tinges of misogyny and responses to the misogyny. We have a lurking psychopath in Karen Sillis' ex-husband, who's just been released from jail. They add an element of danger to the film that gives an edge to the philosophical conversations that seemed a little more ponderous or ponderful, if that's a word. I don't mean it in a negative way, but more the first two films are full of whimsy and wonder, whereas this film has a harder edge and there's always a lurking sense of danger. Some of that danger comes because of the older brother, Bill. Bill's the first brother we meet, and Robert John Burke plays him with some connections to his character of Josh in The Unbelievable Truth, mainly that both of them are mechanics. And Bill here is in the opening scene, which is a heist. He and two partners are in the midst of stealing a bunch of computer components from a warehouse that seem likely to bring in a hefty sum. And Bill is double-crossed. And that's how the film starts. And he's double-crossed by his two partners, but one of whom is also his girlfriend.
Sorry, Bill. It's all over.
What is this?
Vera's with me. I got ideas of my own about how to run things. Vera?
I gotta do what I feel. I gotta be happy.
So, as this journey to look for the boy's father begins, he's on the run from the police because he's still a suspect in the crime. He's angry at the double cross, and he's experiencing some sort of heartbreak, which it's hard to tell how serious he is about it because we never actually see him together with the woman besides those first couple of minutes. But he takes it seriously, and that leads to this scene early in the film when Bill and Dennis are already on the run and they're hiding out for the night in an abandoned diner that's closed down. As Dennis tries to get some sleep because they have a long journey ahead the next day, Bill rants about his broken heart and what he's gonna do about it.
I'll get over it tomorrow.
I'll go to sleep.
But I'm not gonna fall in love anymore.
Fine.
Women don't want you to love them. Tomorrow, the first good-looking woman I see, I'm not gonna fall in love with her. That'll show her. Yeah. The first good-looking blonde woman I see, I'm gonna make her fall in love with me. I'll do everything right. Be a little aloof at first. Mysterious. Seems sort of thoughtful. Deep. But possibly a bit dangerous, too. I'll flatter her in little ways, but be modest myself. They all fall for that shit. Make her fall hopelessly in love with me. Yep. Mysterious. Thoughtful. Deep. But modest. And then I'm gonna fuck her. But I'm not gonna care about her. To me, she's gonna be another piece of ass. Somebody else's little girl who I'm gonna treat like dirt and make her beg for it, too. I'm just gonna use her up. Have my way with her. Like a little toy, a little plaything. And when I'm done, I'm just gonna throw her away.
You through?
I haven't even begun yet.
Go to sleep.
Can't sleep. I'm in pain.
I read that scene as pretty edgy. Robert John Burke has a certain charisma, an obvious charisma, but it's a very stoic charisma. And if you're coming into this film from The Unbelievable Truth, then you've seen a film in that instance where that stoic charisma is played for a mysterious charm. And he maintains that mystery and that charm in this film, but in that scene there's an edge of danger, violence, and misogyny. He wants to hurt a woman, and the nastiness of it is that he doesn't want to hurt the woman he perceives as having hurt him. He wants to hurt anyone. He wants to cause pain. He doesn't want to cause pain to the guy who double-crossed him and stole his girlfriend, or to another random man. He wants to hurt a woman. This scene that we've just looked at is a key to the film, I think, and it's also a key to the title, which is never really explained, but simple men, obviously simple has a lot of meanings. It can mean not all there, but it can also mean just they are who they say they are, simple desires, and so on. What does Bill really want? And the film doesn't double down on asking that question, but his desires do change as the film progresses. And the change in those desires, I think, are part of the narrative arc of the film. And so keeping that scene in mind, as sort of edgy or even nasty as it is important going forward, because I think philosophically, and this is a philosophical film, that moment sets up an argument, and the rest of the film slowly counters that argument. And what comes out at the end, the synthesis perhaps, is a change in perspective. And that's part of the film's power. So I want to talk a little bit about that for the next part of the video. After Bill and Dennis leave the abandoned diner on Ned Rifle's motorbike, they come to another town where they meet Kate, played by Karen Sillis. And Kate runs a small sort of shop diner, which also seems somewhat abandoned. And she also, as I said earlier, plants trees. And she has this goal to sort of plant as many trees as she can. A house guest of hers is Alina, played by Alina Lowenson, and her co-worker, who's in charge of the fish that they sell, is played by Martin Donovan. And the three of them together have sort of unexplained relationships. It's not clear why Alina's there. Martin Donovan's Martin may or may not be together with Kate. We find out later that he's not, but it's not quite clear. At first, he's very protective of her. But Kate very clearly becomes the mark of Bill. Bill, all of a sudden, wants to stop looking for his father, and he wants to play out this game of seduction with Kate. He never verbalizes it. The film doesn't explain all of these motivations, but it's clear in the way that Bill explains to Dennis that he doesn't want to keep going on, that he wants to stay here, and he's got a plan in mind for this. And it leads to this moment where Bill and Kate get in the car and drive to the next town over, because they actually have a tip that the father might be there. And they come to a burned out house, which Bill thinks is obviously his father's work, and that the house has been burned for the insurance money. And then he and Kate have this exchange.
That's what I need. A hobby.
Keeps me busy, and I like that.
I didn't do one thing to make you think you could do that.
I love this exchange because Kate doesn't just rebuke him with the slap. It's what she says, right? I never indicated to you that that would be all right. This is a very sort of thoughtful and I would say thought-provoking comment for 1992. This is a time when there was a sort of reassertion of women's rights in the realm of sexuality. And if you lived through that, you might have remembered a lot of the talk about consent and what we used to call date rape, and that no means no was a very common expression in the early 90s. It still is, but it sort of blossomed at that time. And Kate is kind of embodying that here. And it's not just a no, it's a what led you to, how could you assume, why did you do that? That is not all right. And that's the sort of power of the moment, is what she says after the slap. And we're going to see several slaps in the film where women slap men because the men, not just because they tried to kiss them, sometimes it's because of something they said, but it's because the men overstepped their boundaries. This is a rebuke that's different, and it's about establishing boundaries. And it's one of the things that I think is very interesting about the film, because the film is played as these two brothers sort of exploration of their brotherhood, exploration of their father, but it's also about these two men learning how to be men in relation to women, men who respect women, respect their boundaries, and through that process actually develop some respect for themselves. Eventually, in fact, we find out that Kate does have feelings for Bill, and she explains why she slapped him.
Look, I'm sorry.
I didn't slap you because you kissed me. I slapped you because you thought I couldn't refuse.
So there is a little bit in the film of, I mean, this is a kind of, to use another sort of buzzword of today, a sort of typical kind of heteronormative relationship where she says no and then she says yes. But I think what's interesting about it, what's important about it, is that she clearly delineates the reasons for that, and that it's not just something that's playful or hard to get. Again, even in that scene, she's talking about boundaries. And what follows that are two of the most interesting scenes, I think, in 90s cinema. First, one of the greatest dance scenes ever. They dance to this fantastic early 90s song, Cool Thing, by Sonic Youth. Now, if you know that song, if you don't, go listen to it because it's fantastic. But if you know that song, you know that Kim Gordon's singing along and they're doing their cool dance. But near the end of the song, Chuck D from Public Enemy comes in and Kim Gordon starts talking. She talks over the song and she's addressing the cool thing. And one of the things she says is, what I want to know is, what are you going to do for me? Are you going to liberate us girls from male corporate oppression? Chuck D's going, yeah, tell it, feel it, right? And that's a fascinating song to choose in light of everything that I've just said. And it's immediately after that song where we get the Madonna scene. And I want to show you a slightly different part of that conversation.
The nature of exploitation never improves. It only changes.
Where did you read that?
Is it a feminist achievement for a woman to maintain such control over her own career?
I thought we were talking about music.
Exploitation of sexuality has achieved a new respectability. Because some of those women whose bodies are being exploited have gained control over that exploitation.
They earn more money.
They call the shots.
They're not thought of as victims.
If they earn most of the money, no. They probably don't think of themselves as victims either.
So they are talking about Madonna, and they are talking about sort of female celebrities and women who are sort of public facing. And when I watched this film the first few times in the 90s and a couple times since then, I've often wondered what the point of this scene is. Maybe because I'm a guy and I'm a little bit daft and it didn't occur to me. But I really think in a lot of ways, this scene is an answer to the argument that Bill poses in his misogynist rant from earlier on. Because that kind of, I'm gonna find a woman and make her pay, is a typical Hollywood approach to heartbreak. It doesn't happen in every film, but it has happened in lots of films for 100 years, you know? And that is a sort of male, corporate, patriarchal, misogynist approach to heartbreak. And in a lot of ways, this is maybe a stretch, but I find the dance to Cool Thing and then the switch from talking about, ooh, cool indie music, Kim Gordon, Chuck D, Sonic Youth, to Madonna, that switch alone is fascinating. But both of those two things being juxtaposed with each other are responses to Bill's casual misogyny. And Bill taking part in the Madonna conversation is very important because it seems to me that even though it's a sort of typical 90s, like, let's examine pop culture to sort of ad infinitum, it's also a moment of growth for him where these moments of meeting Kate, being slapped by Kate, experiencing this dance and experiencing this conversation are pushing him to rethink his ideas about women, which by the end of the film are going to push him to rethink himself. And in that ways, Simple Man is not a very simple film. It's different from the first two. In some ways, it's not as easy to fall in love with, but it is also a more adult and a more kind of thoughtful, or maybe not even thoughtful, but difficult film. And it's difficult in a way that I think makes the viewer rethink our conceptions about what indie film could be. And it's very different from the other Madonna conversation from 1992. Very different, refreshingly different, and importantly different. And I don't want to trash that film. I love it. When I first saw it, it blew my mind. Not as much as Trust, but it blew my mind. But there's something different that Hartley's trying to do here that I think is more exploratory, more progressive, and more interesting. And I think it holds up better. Like today, we can watch this Madonna conversation and the other Madonna conversation, and one of them, we can still go, yeah, and the other one is kind of like, really? That was funny once? I don't want to get into the end of the film because there's some really nice surprises, and I kind of spoil films a lot in this series, and I don't want to do it here, but there are a couple other aspects that I want to talk about, and I feel like I've underplayed Dennis, because Dennis is a very interesting character in the film, and his relationship with Alina and her possible potential knowledge about where their father might be is a very important part of the film. So go watch the movie. But I do want to talk about it as a Hartley film just a little bit more before I wrap up.
I'll never forget you guys. Kim, look out!
It's not loaded, look!
Where did you get that weapon?
There's nothing but trouble and desire.
What's this?
It's the Holy Blessed Virgin, you idiot.
Bill gave it to me.
Give it back.
I can't. It's evidence.
Evidence of what?
I don't know.
There's nothing but trouble and desire. 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 There's nothing but trouble and desire.
Ned there is played by Jeffrey Howard, and that scene, I think you can see where, if you compare this, if you've watched my video on The Unbelievable Truth, you compare this to the diner scene. She's crazy, but I love her. This is really pushing the comfortability level of a viewer. Like, what is the point of this? And you might have been sitting in the cinema in 1992 and like, oh, this is funny, this is weird, this is indie, I love it. But just in terms of watching it as a film, that's an odd moment. And Simple Man is full of these, where Hartley takes some of the quirks and these kind of mannered performances that I've mentioned a million times now in the other films and pushes them out beyond even weirdness into a kind of, I would say, sort of Brechtian uncomfortability. And there are layers of irony there. Roger Ebert, when he's talking about this film, he says, Simple Man's basically a melodrama, but Hartley is afraid of melodrama, so he coats it with this irony and this mannerism to hide the melodrama at its heart. That's an interesting reading. I don't think it's necessarily true. Ebert, who's great, didn't get Hartley, and if you go back and read Ebert's reviews, and I've been posting them on the videos, and I will again for this one, he seems to miss something that Hartley's trying to do. And I think what Hartley's trying to do, and I mentioned this in the first video, is examine human connection and examine communication. Communication and touch are really two of our basic forms of connection. And all of Hartley's characters, whether they're wondering about nuclear annihilation or on a road trip to find their father, are looking for something to ground them in this world. And wherever they go, wherever they look, whether it's in books, whether it's in the criminal who's left prison and come back to town, or whether it's in a journey to find their father, wherever they look, they run up against impediments to that human connection. And he embodies those impediments in the films. And I think that's really important because that sense of keeping the viewer at arm's length is intentional. And I don't think it's because Hartley's afraid of the emotion of his films. His films have intense emotions. But to get to those emotions, you have to negotiate these formal impediments. And in a lot of ways, I think Hartley's films are a lot more difficult, a lot more groundbreaking is probably too strong a word, but a lot more sort of forward thinking than some of the bigger name indie filmmakers of the 90s, because he's engaging with the viewer on a whole different level. Whereas some films are like, ooh, that's weird. Oh, that's so cool the way it goes back and forth in time, or ah, it's gross or violent or the dialogue's so funny. In all of those examples, and those are great films, as a viewer, you remain engrossed in the filmmaking process. You might have to go like, wait, when is this? Oh, this has happened before that. Okay, I get it. And then you're absorbed in the story. Hartley's pushing you in interesting ways to prevent you from being absorbed in the story. And then the question you have to ask yourself is, why? Why does a filmmaker do that? That's not what I want from a film. I want to sit down, you know, and watch The Lost Boys. I want to sit down and enjoy this film. Why is he doing this to me? Well, he's doing it to you, first of all, to get you to ask that question. And then as a viewer, to continue to experience the film and the narrative and the characters, which are pretty sort of linear and standard Hollywood narrative, American cinema narrative. You're enjoying the narrative, but you're also asking these questions like, why is this so weird? Why am I uncomfortable about this? Why is it edited this way? Let's look at this scene near the end when Bill and Kate have one of their kind of last conversations with each other.
What happened?
Why are all the men in my life criminal?
Where's Dennis?
He's been arrested.
For what?
For your crimes, no doubt.
Kate, I was gonna tell you everything.
Yeah? When?
In time.
You lied to me.
I never lied to you.
You should leave now. The cops will be here soon.
I don't wanna leave.
Your father's at Martin's boat. Dennis said they'll take you with him.
Take me where?
I don't know.
I gotta go get Dennis.
No. Said not to.
That's some non-standard, non-continuity editing there. And I think when Hartley teams up with Hamilton here for the first time, he finds an editor that, for the first time in these films, who's attuned with his formal approach to filmmaking. And it adds to that sort of level of uncomfortability. Now, that kind of editing was nothing new in 1992. You could go back to 1967 and Bonnie and Clyde, or go back to 1960 and Breathless, and you find this sort of non-continuity editing style. But what I love about how Hartley and Hamilton deploy it here is that it adds to an already sort of formally challenging and performance-based challenging film that's asking you to think about connection. Because what is viewing a film? It's a process of empathy bonding. You watch a film, you meet a protagonist, you get invested in that protagonist. You want to find a reason to root for the protagonist. And once you have created that empathy bond, once you have allowed yourself as a viewer to invest in that story, what do? You go with it. You make a connection, right? And that's why some of your favorite films, you say, I relate to her. I get her. I understand where he's coming from. Even with villains, you know, you're like, I wouldn't do that. I don't like that he did that, but I get it. You have a connection. So as these characters in Hartley's films are trying to make that connection and running up against the difficulties because they can't say what they want to say, they don't know how to express their feelings, they talk past each other all the time, Hartley wants us to really think about this, not just to watch it and get absorbed into it, but to experience it ourselves. And so he uses these approaches that Ebert and others in the 90s thought of as sort of 90s irony or a kind of satire. But I don't think it's that way at all. I think it's a very heartfelt attempt on Hartley's part to ask us to really consider how we make connections. How do we make human connections? What is this movie trying to tell us? And at the end of the film, not everyone makes the connections they want to make, and there's some disappointment. But what's great about the film is that that disappointment brings with it a different kind of satisfaction. And it brings with it a different kind of, dare I say, wisdom. And Simple Man is not my favorite of these three films. Trust is one of my favorite movies of all time. But in some ways, I think Simple Man is the most provocative and the most kind of... it's the one that lingers longer in different ways. It's not just because, oh, that scene was great, or, oh, she looked so good. It's more like, what was that about? And why am I feeling good when they're feeling bad? And why am I feeling bad when they're feeling good? And why is it so weird? And you walk away from it and those questions linger. And I think those questions are meant to provoke you as a viewer. And in that sense, this film has stayed with me on a personal level a lot longer than that other film from 1992, which I love, which I've taught, which I continue to talk to my students about as a kind of inspiration for 90s cinema. But it hasn't sort of penetrated, and there is an irony. Because Hartley's film, Simple Men, Trust, The Unbelievable Truth, they're all about how difficult it is to make a human connection. And they force you to contemplate that in ways that actually penetrate, at least in my case, penetrate beneath my cold, ironic Gen X exterior and linger in me for a long, long time afterwards. Thank you so much for watching. I hope at the least that you've gone out and watched some of these Hartley films. They're hard to get a hold of these days, I know, and this is a guy whose filmmaking career really needs to be revisited and really needs to be better understood. And, you know, watch his films, talk about his films, go watch some of the later ones. They're all really good and they all give you something to think about. And I'll return to him on this channel at some point in the future. But until then, and until next time, thank you so much for watching. I would love it, of course, if you would, boom, hit the like button, doosh, hit the subscribe button. But what I'd really love is if you just drop a comment below. What do you think about Hal Hartley? What do you think about these three films? Did you see them when they came out or since then? Did one of them sort of bing cherries for you more than the other? Or do you love all three? Or do you hate all three? Or did you hate them once and now you're rethinking them? Whatever. Let me know below and I'll engage with you if I can. Thank you so much for watching. My name's Aaron Hunter, and please keep watching movies.
Hendrix, Clapton, Allman Brothers, Zeppelin, Tull, BTO, Stones, Grand Funk Railroad, James Gang, T-Rex, MC5, Skynyrd, Leslie West, Blackmore, The Who, The Old Who. 10 years after, Santana, Thin Lizzy, Aerosmith,
Hot Fucking Tuna.